She worked on issues such as food justice and low-income housing. She was a voice that gave vital momentum and energy to the civil rights movement of the 60s. For African American Heritage Month, on listener-sponsored radio station KPFA, this has been Profiles in Excellence.
This is KPFA, or KPFB Berkeley, or KFCF in Fresno. Online, we're at kpfa.org. It's 2 o'clock with 30 seconds past the hour. Up next is a pre-recorded, this is an archive show of About Health. This is an archive show, so the doctors will not be in-house to take phone calls.
All right, good health and welcome to today's edition of About Health. I'm your host, Dr. Michael Knorr, back from the East and the South, back to bring you a message that all is well in the center of the country, and that spring is in a lot of different places, but winter is in a lot of places as well. Most of you I know are suffering a bit from the allergy season. I know that's a bit of a struggle for you. We've had a big one so far. The trees have been pollinating, and I've been seeing in my own office a number of people. You know, as an allergist, I'm kind of in a quandary. You know, I'm always glad to see the spring come, but then I know that you're going to suffer. And so, I mean, and my job is to heal suffering. So I don't even know how to think about this, but I think most people have been able to survive it pretty well. And now we got to get braced for that grass season. So if you've had a difficult spring, then remember that grass season just starts in the next couple of weeks, and that's kind of the number one. That's the kind of the master G, as we call it, of the pollens in this area. So we really want you to get ready. You know, if you've got that over-the-counter medication, or if you're on medication from your physician, you might want to stock up, because I do believe that this next month and a half is going to be very difficult for people who have allergies, especially grass pollen allergies. Today we've got a special program. In the second hour, part of our hour, we'll be talking with the chairman of the board of the National Medical Association. But before this, we're going to start our conversation with Dr. Willard Edwards. You know, I picked up a book not too long ago, and the book was The Black Woman's Guide to Black Men's Health. Now, you know, when I saw that, I didn't really know exactly what to think, but I did know that the author to be a very credible and very talented, well-known internist, and so I knew she had a point. So as I started to leaf through the book, I started to recognize in that book the object of myself as a male consumer of health, and the role that my wife has played, and I think that this is a my own case is probably a prime example as to why she wrote this book. So we'd like to welcome to our program at this time Dr. Willard Edwards. Dr. Edwards is the author of The Black Woman's Guide to Black Men's Health. Dr. Edwards, thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much, Dr. Lenore. It's my pleasure to be here.
You got to consider me the prime example. Now, I'm supposed to take, first of all, I'm supposed to get physicals every year, you know, so of course I mess around. I say, you know, this basketball, I want to wait till the playoffs. And then I'm supposed to take three tablets a day. One is a cholesterol pill, the other is aspirin, and the third, somebody told me selenium was good for prostate cancer. And my wife lays these pills out in a little box, and of course, you know, if I get three in a week, I'm lucky. So with that as a background, tell us why you wrote this book.
Well, as you just said, women, we know, whether black or of any ethnicity, are the primary decision makers when it comes down to health and health care. We set up the doctor's appointments, make the food choices, and pick the pharmacy, and maybe set up appointments and set out our gentlemen's medicines for them to take. But studies have also shown, and we've heard many of this, of these statistics, that men who have a woman in their life who's actively involved in their health are living longer and have a better quality of life than those who are not connected in some way to a wife, a significant other, daughter, mother, sister, or friend. And why we looked at this particularly among black men is because the statistics are so atrocious with regard to the African men of the African descent having a higher mortality rate for almost all the major diseases.
Give us some of those statistics if you have them.
Sure. We're looking at the top 10 concern, or many, not the top 10, but many of the health concerns. And just talking generally speaking, we're looking at the premature deaths from heart disease, stroke, lung cancer, prostate cancer, colon rectal cancer. This is very high among black men, counter to their, as opposed to their white counterparts. Men have high blood pressure, blood cholesterol, diabetes, and all of this can contribute to the cardiovascular disease and their risk of stroke. also of epidemic proportions is in the black community. Not just black men, but also women have the epidemic of obesity as well. Being obese and overweight, those are other issues that can contribute to chronic disease in the African-American community.
Why do you think men are such bad patients?
Well, you know, as you say that, you know, I think about one of my favorite football stars who just won the trophy this year, Peyton Manning. And one of the commercials that he has is that he says, you know, when something happens, rub some dirt on it or take some Tussin.
Right.
It's like people want to, you know, gentlemen want to man up. And that's part of the problem, I think, is also that just general stigma that they have to be macho. And I'm not sure that we really want that to happen so much.
You know, I have a different take on it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think men are just more fearful than women that something is wrong.
Okay.
I mean, I just really believe that. I mean, my wife, when her mammogram comes up, boy, she just mm-hmm. goes right that same day.
Mm-hmm.
But I think a lot of men are just fearful that they may have something horrible going on.
And as a matter of fact, that's somewhat pointed out in the book when Andrea King Collier, who basically did all the research on this and is definitely promoting this, I, as a medical professional, came along and just read through it, found the book to be very, very practical, very, as you said, mainstream for a lot of people and very easy to read. It's not like a medical reference, but it's easy to read, and that's what I really like, being a part of this book and promoting this health in our community. But one of the things that she points out, too, is the fact that men are not as accustomed to being in the medical area, medical arena, as women are. We, from the time that we're born, you know, we all get our flu shots, not flu shots, but immunizations generally. And then after that, when does the man have to go to the doctor? It's usually not until they get really, really sick about some issue. But usually women are going to see the doctor for their wellness when they become sexually active. They're seeing a GYN doctor. And then they get into the mainstream and constantly going and very accustomed to being in the healthcare arena, whereas men don't usually do it after they've done all their physicals that they may have if they're physically active when it comes down to exercise or qualifying for a varsity team in high school or college. And then they don't see the doctor unless something really, really happens to, that makes them have to go, or unless they have someone else that makes them have to go, like that caring woman.
What does that conversation sound like when you when you're trying to convince a man that you should be in charge of some of this? And what are some of the techniques that women can use to convince men that you know, they shouldn't be not necessarily you wouldn't say that they shouldn't be in charge?
Right.
It doesn't sound like the right thing to say.
Right. Well, but, you know, I know what you're saying. It's about, do we want to be nagging? And the temptation is, after you've read this book, even to become somewhat overpowering. But that's what we also urge you to do, is, you know, don't talk about the negatives. Talk about the positives, about how you really want to have that man around in their very best health, that you want them to be around for their family, their friends, and tell them all the good things about looking out for their health, as opposed to, you know, hurry up and get better because I need you to do this or do that. You want to be more positive in your approach and loving.
So things like, you know, you're too stupid to do this. That's kind of my wife's technique. You know, now you can just be dumb, you know, just, or I won't, here's the other thing. I'm not going to say anything else about it. And so that, you wouldn't advise that technique?
No, I would never advise that technique, and I'm sure you wouldn't either.
Tell us some of the things that we all need to know about organizing for the healthcare system, and the things that that certainly women would be engaged in from the beginning in organizing for themselves and their men's.
Yeah, I like the approach that Andrea gives to this in terms of being informed and keeping records of what's going on with your health. She also, in the book, lays out how easy it is to, or makes it easier for you to understand about health insurance and finding the right doctor, and then just looking out for that the men in your life in terms of their health care, making sure that they're comfortable with the doctor that they see. And there's a lot put upon that whole issue of word of mouth, finding the right doctor that's right for you by talking to other folks that are seeing doctors as well. And I, I think it's a very gentle approach and all. Then also keeping a record of your health care issues so that people are up to date on what's been going on, what medicines they've been taking, what doctors they've been seeing. And it's real simple once you, if you take a notebook with you when you go see the doctor and then write those things down right away as opposed to trying to develop your own medical reference book.
Yeah, we always talk to people about selecting a doctor before you get sick. Mm-hmm. Go in and interview the doctor and look at the facility. Because I think so often men, and especially men of color, when they go into a system, are not always given the kind of introductory respect that is required for a good doctor-patient relationship. So they're selecting that doctor, that primary care person, to steer you through this health care system is critically important, isn't it?
And that's one of the ten tips that we have. Number one is help them to find a doctor that he feels comfortable with and helping him to schedule regular office visits.
Yeah, the other thing is that when you talk about numbers, we always talk about know your numbers.
That's right. Make sure that he knows his important health numbers, such as the blood pressure, cholesterol, the risk of diabetes, and also, as I mentioned before, keeping a health folder for all the test results at home as well as in the doctor's office. Another tip is also knowing as much about your family history as possible, because health history can be an important indicator of your health risk, such as heart disease, diabetes and cancer, colon, rectal, and prostate cancer.
And that's another good tip, because so often we die from what our families die from.
That's true.
And if you're going to really, you're going to really make a statement about your own health and focusing on those things, what's another tip?
Another one is encouraging him to floss. Dental care. People also always think about medical health, but they forget about the dental health, and that's very important.
Yeah, you know, he used to say that, you know, if you can't dance, you can't floss.
What was that?
If you can't dance, you really can't floss. But now they have this machine. I got this little machine that you just press a little button and the little thing, string starts moving, and you just put it between your teeth. And I can't tell you how easier that is and how much it saved me in terms of dental costs.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's
very, very helpful.
And that's one of the things that that many people forget to tell people about their health. I think that's an excellent tip. What's another?
Right, there's a link between gum disease and cardiovascular disease.
Yeah, I have a friend who's told me that the mouth is the something that she says about dentistry, but I do agree that most books on health don't really deal with that piece. I think that's an excellent tip. What's another?
A smart diet choices, making sure that he's getting enough fruit and vegetables, whole grains, and cold water fish.
Cold water fish,
and cutting back on sugary sodas, which we know can be a major cause for weight gain, fried foods, and high-fat desserts.
Now, you know that's a challenge right there. When
you
talk about diets, I mean, you know that's a challenge.
No doubt about it.
Now, tell us about cold water fish and the whole issue around fish oil and how it's good for you.
Well, you just basically hit the nail on the head, because it's about the fish oil that helps a whole lot in terms of your cholesterol and your overall cardiovascular health risk.
All right, another tip.
Moving together. Obesity can affect all aspects of health, and a regular and consistent fitness plan can make a big difference also.
No question. You know, one of the problems, though, especially for African-American men, and not just them, but men who are living in, you know, big urban areas, is that the urban areas are not always designed to assist you in your fitness program. So often they don't have stores in those communities. And then in parts of the Bay Area, if you're running, you're running from something. So you have to really start to look at ways in which communities have to take this on as an issue. But I do think if you want to do it, you can do it.
That's a good point. I know that I can't speak to those areas that don't have stores in the area, but certainly those that are in the urban area don't want to necessarily walk outside their homes, but can get over to a mall. And if you can get in there and do some mall walking, and I always tell people, always tell my patients, walk away from the food court,
right,
then they'll be in better shape.
Yeah, well, the other thing I think, too, is that it is important to try and develop a graduated exercise program. And we do see people who go out and start exercise programs aggressively. But a little bit of walking can lead to a lot of walking, can lead to a much better fitness program. And I do think that that's another important piece. I wouldn't want to walk with my wife in the mall. because there's not much exercise involved in going from store to store,
and
from rack to rack. So, but I do think that there are malls, and we have done programs that will allow you to walk, and mall walking is a very big area for a lot of people, and I think that it's not often utilized. One of the other things that we have heard is that from the people who wrote a book called 50 Simple Ways to Keep Healthy is that your legs are so important as you get older in terms of trying to develop a health fitness program. So I think that's your tip. That's tip number five or six.
That's number six.
All right, let's go to seven.
And then speaking of that and walking and getting moving in the malls, you also can avoid a lot of the other issues that I'm going to next, and that is the sun effect. But the fact is that African Americans, although we're dark and we're not necessarily looking for tans, we do need to use sunscreen. It should be a family habit, and especially making sure that he examines the palms of his hands, soles of his feet, and his body for suspicious moles or lesions that could be the beginning of skin cancer.
Yeah, well, that's interesting you should say that. I think Bob Marley died of a melanoma of the foot.
I have an uncle who was very, very dark, but still had a mole on his back that he had melanoma from and died from.
Well, I think that's interesting because the misconception is that African Americans don't need sunblock.
Yeah.
What are the numbers that you think people should look for in terms of sunblock?
I tell people go for the highest you can get. I mean, I just came from skiing this week, last month, and when we were using 55, everybody.
55. So.
The highest we could find.
All right. So that's another good one. Let's go to the next.
Remember to take his medications as recommended by his health care provider.
Yeah, now that's the tough
tip number eight.
Yeah, that's a tough one.
I think you just mentioned it earlier.
Right, but I do think it is important from the other side to know how well people are doing. You need to know what they're doing on a regular basis so you can modify it either up or down. So that's another good point. What's number nine?
Lift the stigma around mental health, knowing the warning signs of depression and other mental health issues and encouraging him to seek out medical attention is imperative.
You know, one of the big problems with that, and I agree that that's 100%, is finding, certainly in the African-American community, there's a shortage of mental health providers, and some insurances don't even cover mental health, so to the point that you want to do it. And I do think that the conversation between men and women about depression, about obsessive compulsive behavior, about panic attacks, and is a difficult one because I think that is where the machismo comes in.
Mm-hmm.
You don't want to think that you're depressed, and you don't want to put that on anybody else, but I do think that there are great treatments for these illnesses, and I think that that's a good point.
And unfortunately, it's a real stigma in the African-American community, too.
And tip number 10.
10, start young. If you want to have future generations of healthy men and women, we need to make prevention and open conversation about health a priority in all of our homes.
You know, I think that's another good point. I mean, I always say that a three-year-old can't drive to McDonald's. He's got to learn it from somebody else. You really want somebody to start with good health habits, they have to start young.
Yeah. Well, we're talking about smoking. We don't want to be a smoker and then telling people not to smoke.
We're talking with Dr. Willarda Edwards. She is the author and collaborator on the book, The Black Women's Guide to Black Men's Health, a book not just uniquely targeted to the African-American community simply because the discrepancies between our health and the health of the rest of America are so great, but a book for any woman who really cares about the person that they're with, and that could be the uncle, the grandparent, the father, the significant other, the husband. However, I think it is important work. Tell us a little bit about the kinds of the structure of the book also deals with some targeted diseases, and tell us why they were selected and what you have to say about those as it relates to women's involvement in those.
Well, specifically, as I said before, that we're looking at health in various areas. We're looking at the heart disease and stroke, lung cancer and prostate cancer, and colon rectal cancer. Overall, as I look at the practical information that we have here, in the book, they talk about the pharmacist, having a relationship with your pharmacist, getting medical home, and choosing the right local medical doctor, and the steps that you should take in finding the right medical doctor. Because once you have become comfortable with someone that you're getting your health care from, it's more likely that you're going to be able to talk more and have more thoughts about preventive care as opposed to only receiving sick care. Also, in the book, it makes very clear and very simple about the distinction between the various health care coverages, whether you're talking about Medicaid, Medicare, or a PPO or HMO. And it also tells you about long-term care insurance, and then also about collecting your family history. So not only does it talk about those things that you need to prepare to get ready for getting into the healthcare system, but then speaks very specifically about certain things such as I said before, lung cancer, HIV/AIDS, hypertension, cardiovascular disease, stroke, those things.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting, that we come to a similar conclusion. You know, we all heard the term ethnic health disparities.
Mm-hmm.
And what that means is a difference in the health of one ethnic group as opposed to the other, the African-American community probably being as much at risk as any other.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, always when they talk about health disparities, they talk about the solution to health disparities would be that, you know, what we do is identify it, then we go out to the hospitals and the physicians and tell them how bad the situation is, and they would all undergo this metamorphosis,
mm-hmm.
such that they would eventually change to be more sensitive to the needs of ethnic minorities.
Mm-hmm.
Well, no, I don't think that's the way we look at it here, at least in some. So we have a project called the African American Wellness Project, and not to belabor that project,
mm-hmm.
that assumes that health disparities will improve when African Americans become more consistent and sophisticated healthcare consumers and demand from the healthcare system what they need.
Mm-hmm.
And I think this book really gives Black Woman's Guide to Black Men's Health,
mm-hmm.
Gives us another tool that we can use to energize the community to take control.
And
I think that's what this book is about. This book is about taking control of your own health.
Exactly. And it's not your average medical desk reference. I mean, it really does bring it down to home. It makes it very common sense moves and things that people can do right away to change the way that they are approaching healthcare and how healthcare is approaching them.
Now, where is the book available? Everywhere?
It is available by looking at Amazon.com.
Okay.
And anywhere online.
And what about a website?
The website for Amazon.com.
Now, the website, is there a website associated with the book?
You can get more information by going to Warner Books, but I think the Amazon.com is the best way to find the book if you want to order it.
All right. Well, I want to thank you for taking the time. I know that you're very busy scheduled. I'm always very proud to know an author or somebody who's got some celebrity status. And I think that Dr. Willarda Edwards, as I've always known her, to be a very well-organized, a very pragmatic person. I think this book reflects her philosophy. And I think that the philosophy, and the other co-author of the book is?
Andrea King Collier.
Andrea King. And we want to give credit to her as well.
Absolutely.
And I expect that we will, in the Bay Area, we will have a number of people who will be interested in this book. And I think for any woman interested in the health of any man, regardless of relationship, this is without question the health book to have. Thank you, Dr. Edwards, for taking the time.
Thank you very much, Dr. Lenore, for this opportunity.
All right, you're more than welcome. All right, let's continue on to talk. We'll have another conversation with Dr. Carolyn Britton. I don't know whether we've got her on the phone just yet.
Yes, I'm here.
Hello, Dr. Britton, welcome to our program.
Well, thank you very much.
First,
pleasure to be with you.
First, we just got finished interviewing Dr. Willarda Edwards,
mm-hmm.
on her book, The Black Women's Guide to Black Men's Health.
Wonderful.
And the book, she gave us a little premise for the book, but I think that premise, I think we would like to expand with you in our conversation to talk about the health of African Americans, to talk about the ways in which the National Medical Association is approaching the solution, or not, no, there's no solution necessarily, but approaching problem solving in the area of health for African Americans and other underrepresented minorities. So first, let me introduce Dr. Carolyn Britton. She is certainly a very, very famous and well-respected neurologist in the New York area, I think associated with Columbia University. Did I get the Columbia right?
That's correct.
Because, you know, in New York, if you get the wrong university, everybody gets all upset. So this is
Columbia. We'll be in a forgiving mood today.
She has served the National Medical Association, which is the Organization of African American Physicians, both as a regional chair, as a member of the Board of Trustees, and now chairs the board of that very august organization. So we want to thank you very much for coming.
Thanks.
Tell us a little bit about the National Medical Association.
Well, the National Medical Association is one of the oldest premier organizations in the African-American community and in the medical field. It was founded in 1895 at a time when African-Americans were excluded from any continuing medical education or membership in any of the professional societies. And it was formed by people who were dedicated enough to want to have a venue in which they could continue to inform themselves about the latest advances in medicine and to do something that is also quite unique among medical associations, which usually deal with professional matters only. But our association was formed so that it could serve the dual purpose of advocacy for the community and the issues of health, and particularly the elimination of disparities in health. That's language that belongs to the National Medical Association for more than 100 years. So the twin purpose of seeing that physicians had excellent access to education and continued up-to-date information so that we could better serve our communities, and then making sure that our communities had the access at all levels to the kind of care that we believe they deserve. You know, very important mission.
You know, one of the things about the National Medical Association, through the years, we've been advocates for a number of programs that are institutionalized today. A number of programs that our audience, be they African-American or not, have benefited from. Can you just give us a sample of some of those programs where the National Medical Association stood out first and foremost, resulting in better care for both the underserved, the African-American community, and all communities?
Well, I think first, you know, it starts with the point that we are, you talked about Dr. Bullard's important book on health care for African-American men. But I think one of the approaches that we have as a community of physicians is a holistic approach, and we want excellent health care for the entire family. And the things that the National Medical Association did, probably the thing that has effected the most change in American medical health for the entire nation, has been being the only medical association, professional association, to support the passage of Medicare and Medicaid. Our association has been out in front on the issue of universal coverage since its inception. No one would support Medicare and Medicaid funding at the professional medical level when that legislation was introduced, and we were the only association to go to Capitol Hill and testify on behalf of the passage and the benefit to patients, and thus I think the association did a service to the nation because it changed healthcare profoundly. It changed medical education by pouring hundreds of millions of dollars into the continuing education of all physicians and the support of medical education at all of these major universities. And it improved the health of our seniors as well as our vulnerable young and poor. So it was really just a Herculean effort on the part of the National Medical Association and playing an important role in the passage of that legislation.
How is the National Medical Association organized to deal with issues both regionally, locally, and nationally?
Well, it has the benefit of not just being a national association, as many professional associations are. They're national. They're not subdivided into local or regional areas. But we have more than 100 affiliate local societies in not 52 states, but probably 40-some states where we have local representation, both at the state level and several local societies. Say right here in New York City, where I'm located, we have at least four affiliate just in the New York City area, and that doesn't count New York State, where there are other affiliates with the National Medical Association. We also have a state association, the Empire State Medical Association, Georgia State. There are other states that have, and out where you are, you, of course, have the Golden Key. So California is very potent, very, very activist in terms of the commitment and the participation of its physicians. So they have all the state associations, the local affiliates, as well as regions. There are six regions of the NMA that encompass these state and local societies. So we're able to do programmatic initiatives and support all the way from the national level down to an individual city or part of the city. So I think that gives us a lot of power, a lot of amplification for the message, ability to interface with legislators who are interested in health issues at all levels of participation within the country.
And one of the things that makes it so, you know, from the cradle to the grave, African Americans suffer disproportionately from almost any chronic disease.
Absolutely.
Among all of these various and sundry potential problems, how does the National Medical Association decide to prioritize issues related to its community, the communities in which it services?
Well, we look at the importance of the health concern in terms of overall numbers affected. A very good example is asthma. We look for both disproportionate impact in terms of the society. So there are a number of things, plus numbers affected, to tell us where we need to focus attention. Asthma is a great example because the disproportionate impact is just overwhelming. All you have to do is go into emergency rooms around the country and see who's there with asthma and who's there with poorly controlled asthma and who dies of asthma. So that's a great example. The other is diabetes. So we look at these things that we know have high prevalence, that we have a high number of affected individuals in our community, and we have a disproportionate impact in terms of what's called morbidity, that is complications due to the diagnosis, or mortality, death due to the diagnosis. So that's how we select those things. HIV/AIDS is another one of the initiatives that we focus on a great deal because we're just about the only group now that's sort of being affected by this, by new cases within this country, and particularly among women. If you look at children that are born with HIV, although terrifically, that's really come down with the use of antiretrovirals, they're almost all African American. So we select based on prevalence, then proportion of people in the country that have it at any given time, and disproportionate impact in terms of outcome.
Now, one of the other things, we're talking with Dr. Carolyn Bredden. She is the chairman of the board of the National Medical Association, the Organization of African American Physicians. If you want to join us, our number is 1-800-958-9008. 1-800-958-9008, 510-848-4425 in the 510 area code, 1-800-958-9008, or 848-4425 in the Bay Area local number. One of the things that that I think is important for people to understand is that it appears that the number of African American physicians has started to drop in terms of medical school admissions and in terms of capacity to practice. I think one of the things that's always interesting is that when we have an African-American physician, usually there's an interesting story as to how you get to that point. Could you share your story with us?
I hate to share my story because I think it's so odd. It's not odd in that there aren't other people that have it, but sometimes you're born to be a thing. I've known my entire life that I wanted to be a doctor. It's actually been my only career choice since I was maybe 3 or 4 years old. I didn't even know what doctors did. When my brother and I were small, you know, the boy gets the doctor's kit, the girl gets the nurse's kit.
Right.
I opened up my nurse's kit, and guess what? There were no pills, so I couldn't cure anybody. So my brother, who preferred his trucks, I promptly went over there, took his doctor's kit, took the pills out, told my mother, don't get me one of these other things because there are no pills and nobody's going to get well. You know, you had the little candy pills in your thing. So I've had the good fortune for having that interest as a small child without any clue as to why I had the interest in medicine per se, although I think generally like many other people who go into medicine, you really do have a sincere desire to be helpful to people. And having that married with the fact that as time went on, I had an interest in the sciences. And so I was fortunate in the sense that the interest that I had matched the academic interest and the skill that I had. So you have interest with opportunity. So some of these things are gifts that we get. you know, it's a blessing, so to speak, that you have the ability, and other things that you can't control, like the opportunity or being given the physical stamina to actually be able to do it. So for me, it was one of those things. And I do think that perhaps on subconscious level, as I had our family doctor was a graduate of Meharry, who was a very devoted man. He would ride his bicycle all over the country, you know, being paid in chickens and apple pies. So to give you your injections and stuff like this, and to look in your throat, and to pat you on the back and to make you feel better. And I think just as a persona, being fortunate enough to be in a place where I had a black physician, we had the black nurse who gave us all our injections. Very early on, I saw people who were blacks who were in that profession that I admired, you know, that did great service within the community. And I think subconsciously, I bonded with that persona and wanted to be like them. So I think lucky is the child that gets to have a black doctor in their community, or one that they get to interface, because they get to sort of, on a conscious or subconscious level, have that as a role model. And I had that, and I think that's very fortunate.
Tell us a little bit about your education.
Oh, I went to college in Ohio and went to medical school here in New York, and did some graduate work also in microbiology and virology. So I'm actually a neurovirologist, which is a mouthful. But I have an interest in infectious diseases of the nervous system and para post-infectious or inflammatory disorders. So I see patients. I did a lot of work with HIV about 20 years ago and was among the first to describe the neurologic complications of HIV infection, and also work with patients with MS, as well as the general neurology practice. More recently, I've been doing some research with Lyme disease. So I've done both bench research and clinical research and clinical practice. I've had a number of things that I've been involved in, as well as teaching and administration. I ran our outpatient department for about 14 years. So a lot of things, medical education, working with students, working with, you know, young physicians in practice. I think there's an awful lot that one can do in medicine, the community education projects, and it's been rewarding.
1-800-958-9008, 510-848-4425. Dr. Carolyn Britton, who is the chair of the board of the National Medical Association, is our guest. Let's start with Mark in Berkeley. You're on About Health. Mark?
I appreciate it very much. You know, you're talking about medicine here in the United States, and we did some research about the insurance companies in the United States that are you know, servicing with health care, and I'd like to throw some numbers out at you and then sit back and hear what you think about it. Well, in the United States, because we have so many different insurance companies, there are different forms. So every hospital has to have about three or four administrators just to be able to bill the different insurance companies. And that costs about 25 cents for every dollar. Up in Canada, with a single payer, because it's only one form, and it's a very simple form, and the government is the one that pays, is only 2.5 cents for every dollar. And then you take into consideration the profits that the insurance companies are taking in. It's approximately 33 cents for every dollar. So right there, we're looking at about 58 cents of every dollar is taken up for administrative costs and for profit, simply because we don't have single payer. And I would like to hear what you guys think about that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mark. Your response, Dr. Britton?
I think that that's a very, very thoughtful analysis of one of the problems that we face with healthcare in general. The issue is whether or not we're going to have a for-profit or a not-for-profit system. In the past, when hospitals, before these for-profit hospital entities came on board, hospitals were not-for-profit, which meant that if they made excess revenue over expenses, they would reinvest that back into the hospital system. And what this gentleman is pointing out now is we have a system now where, quote-unquote, profit comes off the system. But that profit comes at an expense. It comes at the expense of reinvestment into the system for new technologies. It comes at the expense of being able to cover everybody who has need. So I think it is an excellent point. I can't verify those numbers, but I do know that the numbers, if you add our administrative overhead, is enormous because of the complexity of the billing system and multiple billers, and many of whom make it very difficult to get the billing accomplished. There is no question that there are many things that can be done. You don't necessarily need a single payer. That's not the only answer. You can simply have a paperwork reduction thing. You can simply, there are many ways in which you can approach it. A single payer is one way, but if you were going to have universal coverage, you can have a single form. There's no reason to have all of these different forms or different codes. There's way to get uniformity and to achieve tremendous cost savings without, however, having some way that that money goes back to the patient. The cost savings would still go out of the system as profit to the people, and then that's gone from the system forever. And our real challenge is going to be going forward, how do we identify the funds for reinvestment in new technologies, and how do we make sure that any patient who has need has access? So I think extremely good point, very thoughtful.
Does the National Medical Association have a position on universal health care?
Yes, we supported always universal health care. And the issue comes up, do you support single payer or do you support universal health care? If you get into a single payer argument, that's one way of achieving universal health care, but you end up, if you have other proposals that don't want to deal with single payer, you are only in that way of doing the payment. So we've chosen the language of universal coverage. It could be universal coverage through single payer. It could be universal coverage through multiple payers that are managed in a certain way to achieve the goal of paperwork reduction, simplicity, and accessibility. So I think you have to articulate what your goals are, and then you say, whichever way you're going to get there. But it should be simple, it should be direct, and it should be accessible. I agree with the caller.
Our guest, Dr. Carolyn Britton, she's the chairman of the board of the National Medical Association, a very, very well-respected neurologist, I dare say famous neurologist in the New York area. If you want to join us, 1-800-958-9008 or 510-848-4425. Let's go to James in Oakland. You're in about health.
Hi, very interesting and excellent show.
Thank you, James.
One of the problems I think in the black community, especially for black males, for the community in general, is health insurance. I had Kaiser in the past, and I started to participate in one of the health centers in Oakland. I did an EKG. I was told I had a heart attack, and I couldn't believe it because there was no symptoms.
Right.
My problem is this. Because I don't have insurance, how can I follow up? What should I do? I'm beginning to exercise more, eat more fruits and vegetables, and so on. Can you give me some feedback, please? And let me add one more thing, just for your audience. I used to have numbness in my legs, but I started to stretch.
Mm-hmm.
And the numbness kind of removed. I mean, I have to do it on a regular basis, but there's no numbness when I just stretch my back. So if anybody's having that problem, that might be helpful. But give me some feedback on the silent heart attack, the EKG, and where can I do and where can I go without insurance? Thank you very much.
I don't know where you are.
I'm here in the city of Oakland.
You are in Oakland.
Yes.
Okay. Well, perhaps Dr. Lenore can help with that.
First of all, when you have that kind of a symptom, that requires almost immediate intervention because you really don't know what that means. That means you may have had one. You may have some continuing disease which contributes to that. And so I think that's the first thing. I think the second thing is that we do have a system, a network system, which is not particularly perfect, but it's certainly not a bad system, and that's called the county hospital.
Okay.
And the county hospital in this area, and I think in many of the other areas, is demonized by a PR image which is not consistent with the way county hospitals operate today.
Okay.
Highland Hospital is probably one of the finest county hospitals in the country, as is San Francisco General Hospital.
Okay.
And so consequently, if I were you, I think the first thing I would do is to try to face at the primary care clinic at the county hospital. And there are some outlying clinics as well where access is really determined not so much on the basis of need, on the basis of your ability to pay, but on the basis of need. So that's the first thing. You have to do all of that because at the end of the day, if you don't get this taken care of now, then what you, the price you will pay is an escalation of the disease process. It will eventually cost you more, and you will still have only the same options.
Mm-hmm.
So I think the county, that we're gifted in this area by having two very fine health, the county health departments, the Alameda County Health, three, actually Contra Costa, Alameda, and San Francisco. We have two fine county hospitals and county hospital systems, and I think that entering that system in primary care, if, sooner rather than later, is what you need to be doing.
Okay, now let me ask you a question. What county hospital here in Oakland can I go to?
Highland.
Thank you very much.
Best in the country.
Yeah, I concur with that. I think particularly before exercising, if you've had silent ischemia, which is what that is loss of blood supply showing damage to heart muscle on an EKG, that should certainly be fully evaluated before you're on an exercise program because you cannot know. But some people are not symptomatic until it's a very big symptom. So you want to make sure that that's done. And it sounds like there are resources there to accommodate. So that's great.
Thank you. You've been very helpful.
All right. You're more than welcome. Let's go to Alfredo in Mountain View. You're on About Health. Alfredo? Come on down.
Yeah, great show, Dr. Leonard. It's always a pleasure. I wanted to also mention the fact that, unfortunately, we still put little focus on preventing diseases. The American medical establishment focuses primarily on treating diseases, preventing them, and this compounds the problem with the insurance problem as well. And so we, if your guest could comment about also that, because we do have the ability to prevent diseases and take care of ourselves and you know, for the future.
Oh, I think that that's a great thing. Of these options that everyone should exercise are not mutually exclusive options. I think that every person from birth to death should have a person that they call their personal physician. You all need that option. You don't know if you're going to get hit by a bus or whatever, but there should be somebody in the medical system who's going to have responsibility for you and whose job it is to be able to access other parts of the medical system you may or may not need. But that being said, I think that the emphasis on two things, one, prevention and early detection, because we're not going to be able to prevent 100% of things, but we can certainly delay their onset, we can make them better, and we can improve our outcomes should we have an illness by focusing on those simple things like diet, exercise. It's really, it's not like a list of hard things to do, like climbing Mount Everest. For us to stay in shape and stay fit and to watch our weight, to do all of those things that we can do. The use of complementary medicine, other techniques, supplements, there's a vast literature on it, and it's by no means considered the enemy of what's called allopathic medicine, the normal medicine where we treat diseases. Because I think if all of us had our druthers, we'd rather people not have diseases, or if they have diseases, us be able to manage them to the best outcome possible. And we can't do that without the persons participating in the maintenance of their own health. So I completely agree.
All right. Good comment, Alfredo. As usual, let's go to Ed and Colgan. You're on About Health.
Yeah, I wanted to talk about the Cuban, couple things. First off, the Cuban offer of 500 scholarships to the Latin American School of Medical Studies in Havana for U.S. students, low-income U.S. students. And also the Cuban model of healthcare in general, which they have developed, which makes it a lot more accessible in terms to people who don't have the resources, rather than trying to fund all of the expensive high-tech. They've developed models of a lot lower-tech stuff and more preventative stuff. I was first wondering if you knew anything or had heard about the Cuban offer of med school scholarships.
Yes, as a matter of fact, I do. I know that there have been people years ago, before there was a ban, people had made trips looking at this, because one of the real conundrums we have is not being able to get up the numbers of students, minorities in medical students, in medical schools in this country. It was supposed to be 5,000 by 3,000, by 2,000. Was that it, Dr. Lenore?
Yes.
We're far off that mark. I mean, nowhere near it. And things really, when the anti-affirmative action groups took over about 10, 12 years ago, they really did all they could to drive down the numbers in some schools to near nothing. So that was very effective, and it sort of put a damper on young people applying to medical school. But there's also a second aspect, and that is that there were also jobs that opened up in other fields. So some of the people who used to see medicine as the place to go if you wanted to have high professional achievement, now want to run major law firms or be successful in business, so they do have other options. So it's a mixed kind of picture. Nevertheless, this offer was put before a delegation to travel from the NMA that traveled there several years ago to offer places to medical students, to low-income medical students from this country, minority medical students. It has been something, as a practical matter, we have not been able to pick up on. But I think that they certainly have solved the issue in that country of how you make available to you everything that you have at the preventive and the treatment level. I mean, they have very, very smart physicians, and they really excel in some ways. And given the economic limitations that have been put on them, I think they do an excellent job for the population. But it is not going to be the case. It doesn't end up to be a perfect model, I think, for this country. I think on the preventive end, there's a lot of lessons everybody can learn as to how you do that and how you make it work and how you implement excellent preventive and early treatment interventions, immunizations, things like that. But this is a country that is going to demand high tech. And so you're going to have the demand to do those things to treat diseases that people are going to get. People are going to have cancer, and they're going to want to live. They're going to have something at some point. They may have Parkinson's disease. They're genetic disorders. So there are a number of disorders that you're going to have that are going to exist in a population that are not preventable. So I don't think that we want to necessarily sacrifice one for the other. But I do think that there is no excuse for a country that has the technological sophistication that we have not to have the basics in place. It doesn't make any sense. And so I think we all are concerned about that kind of mismatch. It doesn't make sense to be able to do the most sophisticated heart transplant or liver transplant or double lung transplant, and you can't immunize children. So I agree that, that's something that definitely needs to be done, and there are many models, including those in Cuba, that we can look at and learn.
Thank you very much for that.
Well, just one thing. Actually, regarding these scholarships, there are actually 500 total scholarships being offered.
Mm-hmm.
Pastors for Peace in New York is coordinating the applications. There are students. One's in her fifth year now. And these are, room board and tuition full scholarships that the Cuban government is offering. There is a recording of a conference on San Francisco Indie Media. It was put up on the 3rd of this month, 3rd of April.
Mm-hmm.
It's at www.indiebay.org. It's about Pastors for Peace promoting the free Cuban med school, and there's like a couple of hours worth of presentations and interviews there for people who want to find out more about that.
Oh, great.
Well, thank you for taking the time to call.
You're certainly welcome.
Yeah, one of the things this brings up, Dr. Britton, is that this whole issue of manpower. I mean, I think we do know that when we talk about the disparities, we've talked enough for people understand that concept. One of the concepts that is pretty clear is that physicians who come from communities tend to go back to those communities to practice.
Right.
What is the strategy of the National Medical Association to increase the number of African-American and medical students and students from underserved areas to go into medical careers and to cross the barriers that are now being placed in front of them, not only by the current climate around affirmative action, but by the Any Child Can requirements to teach toward a certain objective. Well, what can we do? Because one of the reasons I ask this question, it is pretty clear that your story is very similar to my story or other people, is that I pretty much knew that I wanted to go to college before the sixth or seventh grade. And what I understand now is that if you don't encourage students to go into higher education, be that medicine or whatever, before that period, you're really not going to get a successful outcome.
That's correct. That is the most critical point. We have to be starting in kindergarten. I think the one of the things that we're going to have to figure out how to do, there are many, many programs that try to interact and interface with students from minority communities. What we don't have is a kind of seamless effort. The National Medical Association has a number of things that it does. I mean, it has its own scholarship support for students. There's the Student National Medical Association that we partner with. Through the auxiliary to the National Medical Association, we have mentoring programs for students in high school. But high school is really already too late, particularly for our young men. They're dropping out before they're in sixth grade. They're being so demoralized and shunted to the back of the system. And I don't know if there's one solution, but I think that we need some sort of summit to deal with it, because the losses are just enormous. We are losing tremendously bright children, and we know what happens to them if they don't graduate high school. If they don't graduate high school, they might as well just go to the judge and get a jail sentence, because that's where so many of them end up. So I think that you're correct. It's got to start much earlier. The child has got to know early on they've got to be college-bound and connected. And that's what I meant about, you know, having the fortune of having a black physician and the black nurse that gave us all injections, Nurse Dent, you know. She was stood there looking all formal in her pressed white. You know, you walked in and you saw people who could do things. These were important people. And you know, you felt connected to them. You were one of them. They look like you. And so I think that that's very important, critically important. But starting in the early grades and really having a way that we can do seamless mentoring all the way through. There are lots of different programs. They're not connected to each other. And I think finding a way for people to know the resources available to them and to access them is probably the biggest thing that needs to be done.
As you look at the things across the table for the National Medical Association to be engaged in, what do you think, in just a sentence or two, is the most important rationale for an organization like the National Medical Association to be in place?
Most important thing right now is actually to get access to health care, to make sure that that's accomplished, that we get universal coverage and that we get access to health care. The second thing is we really got to assure that we are continuing to produce physicians for our community. There's that old song you may remember, God bless the child that's got his own. That is true of us in health. If we don't have our own practitioners, people who are interested in our issues, we don't have people that take our issues to the agenda table and say, this is what we need research on. This is what we need treatment for. These are the questions that need to be asked. So for our association to be there and to continue to develop a research initiative, a policy agenda, as well as the access to health care through providing insurance to everyone, regardless of ability to pay, is the most critical things that we can accomplish. But the continuing education piece and the education of new physicians, who's going to replace us? That's the question that's always got to be in our mind.
Dr. Carolyn Britt, Chairman of the Board of the National Medical Association, thank you for taking the time.
Thank you very much, Dr. Lenore. It was a pleasure.
All right. Well, certainly this time has gone by very quickly. Remember the book, The Black Woman's Guide to Black Men's Health, is really a woman's guide to men's health. Look it up on Amazon.com. And thanks again to Dr. Britton, the National Medical Association. Thanks to Mickey, who does for me everything that can be done. And most of all, thank you for joining us on another edition of About Health. Remember, health is your biggest asset. I'm Dr. Michael Knorr. We'll talk again next week.
Hello, listeners. This is a correction to information that was mentioned earlier. I just want to let you folks know that Mary Berg is fine. She has not had a heart attack or stroke. She was here Sunday morning, and she is doing well. So Mary Berg is fine. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Joan, a longtime listener of KPFA. This is a message to other listeners who, like me, want to see that KPFA remains a vital presence on the airwaves. Did you know that you can ensure KPFA continues in its independent mission into the future? To learn about planned giving, call Jan at 510-848-6767, extension 255, or email her at jan@kpfa.org. On the web, go to kpfa.org/support for more information.